Rita Hayworth and Shawshank Redemption. By Stephen King. There's a guy like me in every state prison in America, I guess. I'm the guy who can get it for you. Tailor-made cigarettes, a bag of reefer, if you're partial to that, a bottle of brandy to celebrate your son or daughter's high school graduation, almost anything within reason. It wasn't always that way. I came to Shawshank when I was just 20. I'm one of the few people in our happy little family who's willing to own up to what he did. I committed murder. I killed my wife. Given a second chance, I would not do it again. But I'm not sure that means I am rehabilitated. Before I can tell you about Andy Dufresne, I have to explain a few other things about myself, and it won't take long. As I said, I've been the guy who can get it for you here at Shawshank for damn near 40 years. That doesn't mean just contraband items like extra cigarette or booze. I've gotten thousands of other items for men doing time in here. I've gotten men chocolates on Valentine's Day. I got three of those green milkshakes they serve at McDonald's around St. Patty's Day for a crazy Irishman named O'Malley. I even arranged a midnight showing of Deep Throat and The Devil and Miss Jones for a party of 20 men who pooled their resources to rent the films, although I ended up doing a week in solitary for that little escapade. It's the risk you run when you're the guy who can get it. I've gotten reference books, and on more than one occasion, I've seen that a long-timer has gotten a pair of panties from his wife or girlfriend. I don't just do it for money. What good is money for me? I'm not going to fly off to Jamaica for 2 weeks in February. I do it for the same reason a good butcher will sell you fresh meat. I got a reputation, and I want to keep it. The only two things I refuse to handle are guns and heavy drugs. I have enough killing on my mind to last a lifetime. So when Andy Dufresne came to me in 1949 and asked if I could smuggle Rita Hayworth into the prison for him, I said it would be no problem at all. And it wasn't. Andy came to Shawshank in 1948. He was 30 years old, a short, neat little man with sandy hair and small, clever hands. He wore gold-rimmed spectacles. His fingernails were always clipped, and they were always clean. That's the funny thing to remember about a man. He always looked as if he should be wearing a tie. On the outside, he had been a vice president in the trust department of a large Portland bank. Good work for a man as young as he was, especially when you consider how conservative most banks are. Andy was in for murdering his wife and her lover. Of course, everyone in prison is an innocent man. They were victims of judges with hearts of stone and balls to match, incompetent lawyers, police frame-ups, and bad luck. Most cons are no good to themselves or anyone else. And their worst luck was that their mothers carried them to term. In all my years in Shawshank, there are less than 10 men whom I believe when they told me they were innocent. Andy Dufresne was one. It was one hell of a case, all right. One of those with all the right juicy elements. A beautiful girl with society connections, dead. A local sports figure, also dead. And a prominent young businessman in the dock. The facts of the prosecution's case, Andy never contested. His wife was Linda Collins Dufresne. In June 1947, she expressed an interest in learning the game of golf at the Falmouth Hills Country Club. She took lessons for 4 months. Her instructor was the Falmouth Hills golf pro, Glenn Quinton. In late August 1947, Andy learned that Quinton and his wife were lovers. Andy and Linda Dufresne argued bitterly on the afternoon of September the 10th, 1947. The subject of the argument was her infidelity. She planned to obtain a Reno divorce, and Andy told her he would see her in hell before he'd see her in Reno. She went off to spend the night with Quentin in Quentin's rented bungalow not far from the golf course. The next morning, his cleaning lady found them both dead in bed. Each had been shot 4 times. The DA, with political aspirations, made a great deal of that. Andrew Dufresne, he said, was not a wronged husband seeking a hot-blooded revenge against his cheating wife. That, the DA said, could be understandable if not condoned. Consider, the DA thundered at the jury, 4 and 4. Not 6 shots, but 8. He had fired the gun empty and then stopped to reload so he could shoot each of them again. 4 for him and 4 for her, the Portland Sun blared. The Boston Register dubbed him the Even Steven Killer. A clerk from the Wise Pawn Shop in Lewiston testified that he had sold a 6-shot .38 police special to Andrew Dufresne 2 days before the murder. A bartender from the country club testified that on the evening of the 10th of September, Andy had come in around 7 o'clock, had 3 straight whiskeys in a 20-minute period. When he got up from the barstool, he told the bartender he was going up to Quentin's house, and he, the bartender, could read about the rest of it in the papers. A clerk from the Handy Pick store, a mile or so from Quentin's house, told the court that Dufresne had come in around 8:45 that same night. He purchased cigarettes, 3 quarts of beer, and some dish towels. The county medical examiner testified that Quentin and the Dufresne woman had been killed between 11 p.m. and 2 a.m. on the night of the 10th and 11th of September. The detective from the attorney general's office, who had been in charge of the case, testified that there was a turnout less than 70 yards from the bungalow. 3 pieces of evidence had been removed from that turnout. 2 empty quart bottles of Narragansett beer with the defendant's fingerprints on them. 2nd, 12 cigarette ends, all Cools, the defendant's brand. 3rd, a plaster moulage of a set of tire tracks matching the tread and tire wear pattern of the tires of the defendant's 1947 Plymouth. In the living room of Quentin's bungalow, 4 dish towels had been found on the sofa. There were bullet holes through them and powder burns on them. The detective theorized, over the agonized objections of Andy's lawyer, that the murderer had wrapped the towels around the muzzle of the murder weapon to muffle the sound of the gunshots. His lawyer invited Andy to tell the jury what had happened after his wife left to meet Glenn Quinton on the night of the murders. Andy told them, and the impression he made was the worst possible. I knew him for close to 30 years, and I can tell you he was the most self-possessed man I've ever known. He was the type of man who, if he had decided to commit suicide, would do it only when his affairs were neatly in order. He told a story like a recording machine, seeming to say to the jury, "This is it. Take it or leave it." Well, they left it. He said he was drunk that night, that he had been more or less drunk since the 24th of August. The jury just couldn't see this coldly self-possessed young man in the neat, double-breasted woolen suit ever getting falling down drunk over his wife's sleazy little affair with some small-town golf pro. I believed it because I had a chance to watch the Andy that those 6 men and 6 women didn't have. Andy Dufresne took just 4 drinks a year all the time I knew him. He would meet me in the exercise yard every year about a week before his birthday, and then again 2 weeks before Christmas. On each occasion, he would arrange a bottle of Jack Daniels. He bought it the way most cons arrange to pay for their stuff. The slave wages they pay in here, plus a little of his own. On the morning of his birthday, the 20th of September, he would have himself a big knock. Then he'd have another that night after light out. The following day, he gave the rest of the bottle back to me, and I would share it around. As for the other bottle, he dealt himself 1 drink Christmas night and another on New Year's Eve. That one would also come to me with the instructions to pass it on. He told the jury that on the night of the 10th, he had been so drunk he could only remember what had happened in isolated snatches. After she left to meet Quentin, he remembered deciding to confront them. On the way to Quentin's bungalow, he swung into the country club for a couple of quick ones. He could not, he said, remember telling the bartender he could read the rest of it in the newspapers, or saying anything to him. He remembered buying the beer at the Handy Pick, but not the dish towels. Why would I want dish towels? One of those papers reported that three of the lady jurors shuddered. Much later, he speculated to me about the clerk who had testified on the subject of those dish towels, and I think it's worth jotting down what he said. Suppose that during that canvass for witnesses, Andy said one day in the exercise yard, they stumbled on this fellow who sold me the beer that night. By then, 3 days had gone by. The facts of the case had been in the papers. Maybe they ganged up on the guy. Cops, somebody from the Attorney General's office, plus the DA's assistant. Yeah. If enough people want you to remember something, that can be a pretty powerful persuader, Red. I agreed that it could. Andy went on. It's at least possible that he convinced himself. It was the limelight. Reporters asking questions, his picture in the papers, all topped, of course, by his star turn in court. I think it's possible that he could have passed the lie detector test with flying colors, or sworn on his mother's sacred name that I bought those dish towels. Memory is such a goddamn subjective thing. I know this much. I was pig drunk, too drunk to have been thinking about muffling gunshots. If I'd done it, I just would have let them rip. He parked in the turnout, drank beer, and watched the lights downstairs in Quentin's place go out. He watched a single light go on upstairs, and 15 minutes later, he watched that one go out. Mr. Dufresne, did you then go to Glenn Quentin's house and kill the two of them? His lawyer thundered. No, I did not, Andy answered. By midnight, I drove home. I was beginning to think that the wisest course would be to simply let her go to Reno and get her divorce. You divorced her in the quickest way you could think of, didn't you? You divorced her with a .38 revolver wrapped in dish towels, didn't you? No, sir, I did not. And then you shot her lover? No, sir. You mean you shot Quentin first? I mean I didn't shoot either one of them. You told the jury that between the 24th of August and the 10th of September, you were feeling suicidal enough to buy a revolver. Yes, sir. Would it bother you over much, Mr. Dufresne, if I told you that you do not seem to be the suicidal type? No, but you don't impress me as being terribly sensitive, and I doubt very much that if I were feeling suicidal, that I would take my problem to you. Did you take your .38 with you on the night of the 10th of September? No, as I've already testified. Oh, yes. You threw it in the river, didn't you? The Royal River, on the afternoon of the 9th of September, 1 day before the murders. Yes, sir. That's convenient, isn't it? It's neither convenient nor inconvenient, only the truth. The police found no gun, although they dragged the river for 3 days. So no comparison can be made between the riflings on the bullet taken from the bloodstained corpses of your wife and Mr. Glenn Quentin and the riflings on the barrel of your gun. That's also convenient, isn't it? Since I am innocent of this crime, sir, and since I'm telling the truth about throwing my gun into the river the day before the crime took place, then it seems to me decidedly inconvenient that the gun was never found. The DA hammered at him for 2 days. The case went to the jury at 1 p.m. on a snowy Wednesday afternoon. The 12 jurymen and women came back at 3:30. They would have been back earlier, but they had held off in order to enjoy a nice chicken dinner from Bentley's restaurant at the county's expense. If Maine had the death penalty, he would have done the air dance before that spring's crocuses poked their heads out of the dirt. I never felt close to Andy until 1960 or so, and I believe I was the only one who did get close to him. Both being long-timers, we were in the same cell block from beginning to end. I was halfway down the corridor from him. What do I think? He laughed. I think it must have been some stranger just passing through. Maybe a burglar, maybe a psychopath. He killed him, that's all. And I'm here. As simple as that. He was condemned to spend the rest of his life in Shawshank. 5 years later, he began to have parole hearings. He was turned down just as regularly as clockwork in spite of being a model prisoner.